I found some animal rights activists, a father and son team, who I call the dog catchers, and they were sneaking around the barricades and through the hills and finding ways to get inside, and I followed them. And I was photographing them and what they were doing, feeding animals, saving them. And then they gradually became sort of invested in what I was doing, and they started to see that I was trying to tell a broader story inside Fukushima. Well, the story is about people, and I went to a place where there's no people. So I wanted to find a way to show the signs of their life, what they left behind, footprints in the road. There were bowls of food left on people's tables. There were, you know, pets. There were, everyone's life was just suspended and they disappeared. Also, you're trying to show that the place is contaminated and radiation is invisible. So you had to rely on sort of mood. You had to rely on, you know, you felt like the place was buzzing when you were there, but how do you show that in a picture? That was the real challenge, you know, not only that, but that there just aren't any people there to show. So it's just emptiness, and you're feeling afraid and anxious, and your radiation meter is beeping, and then how do you show that in a picture? Because in a lot of ways, the pictures look like Sunday morning at 6 a.m. There's no one on the streets. It just looks like a normal town. So yeah, it was a real challenge to try and make you feel like this was a poisoned place. I think the geographic editors selected the first picture in the series as the opening picture, because it achieved what I just said that I was trying to achieve, which is to show signs of life and how the people, what they left behind. So it's a photo of footprints in the cracked mud left in this town. I think that everyone felt that picture really started it off, made you feel like something is not right here. For me, the photo that I remember most is the first day that I went. It's a picture of one of the dog catchers who I traveled with. And we went to as close to the nuclear power plant as we could. We were walking along the coast. The coast was completely devastated. My radiation meter was beeping. The radiation levels were very high, and I had just arrived and I was really afraid. And he was leading the way, and he turned and looked over his shoulder at me. And I don't know that the reader will, that photo will tell the story to them quite like the others, but for me he was the guy that helped me. We were trying to do something together and we were both afraid, and we were walking very hesitantly towards the reactor, and so that to me is kind of sums up my experience there more than the other pictures probably. I wasn't able really to go officially into the exclusion zone. The governments were trying to, at least with the foreign media, trying to keep us back. But I made friends with people. I met them in shelters. They were living in cardboard boxes, and they had them organized by towns. And so I got to know people. And they had a program where they allowed people to go in on a two-hour bus trip to collect a few things. They had one bag in 2 hours. They have to wear all the suits, and they would go in and put everything they need, they could carry. I got to accompany one family into their home while they had this two-hour period and watch what they did and photograph what they did. They went into their attic and they folded all of their belongings, you know, his best suit and all the family photos, and sort of said goodbye to their place. And that was a really important piece of the story for me to see. Because I had only seen these people outside of the exclusion zone. So to see them inside and like in their own home and like saying goodbye was really interesting and important. You know, the people who came, there's close to 100,000 people from those towns, and they all had to, I mean, they sat for days just completely exposed to radiation with no information, and they've left behind their homes, which are a really beautiful and historic part of Japan. These homes were in families for probably 400 to 500 years, and they don't know what's happening inside. And I feel like the risk that I faced was very tiny compared to what they did. I'm not the only person that's gone in, but I'm certainly the one that's been working on this story the most, and I feel like I should keep going with it.